الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. والسماء بنيناها بأيد وإنا لموسعون، والأرض فرشناها فنعم الماهدون، ومن كل شيء خلقنا زوجين لعلكم تذكرون. ففروا إلى الله، ففروا إلى الله، إني لكم منه نذير مبين. ولا تجعلوا مع الله إلها آخر، إني لكم منه نذير مبين. كذلك ما أتى الذين من قبلهم من رسول إلا قالوا ساحر أو مجنون. أتواصوا به، بل هم قوم طاغون. فتول عنهم فما أنت بملوم. وذكر فإن الذكرى تنفع المؤمنين. وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. ما أريد منهم من رزق وما أريد أن يطعمون. إن الله هو الرزاق ذو القوة المتين. فإن للذين ظلموا عذابا دون ذلك، فإن للذين ظلموا ذنوبا مثل ذنوب أصحابهم فلا يستعجلون. فإن للذين ظلموا ذنوبا مثل ذنوب أصحابهم فلا يستعجلون. فويل للذين كفروا من يومهم الذي يوعدون. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Amen. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون لا يستوي أصحاب النار وأصحاب الجنة أصحاب الجنة هم الفائزون لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم الله
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته ما شاء الله بارك الله فيكم I love that energy جزاكم الله خيرا to our brothers and I'm sure our sisters have also said وعليكم السلام جزاكم الله خير and dear brothers and sisters alhamdulillah I would like to welcome you to Al Furqan Masjid in this evening alhamdulillah we have with us Ustaz Yahya Rabi and I don't have to introduce him anymore ما شاء الله you know him so well you guys love him so well ما شاء الله And alhamdulillah, we've been enjoying his beautiful recitation, beautiful reminders. And alhamdulillah, we have a lot of young brothers here with us. And also, inshallah ta'ala, we have sisters as well who are listening and benefiting from this important lecture, inshallah ta'ala. The lecture title for tonight is Knowing Allah is so important, especially to our young brothers and sisters. And for all of us, very, very important. It's important to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And how we're going to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, this is going to be a journey through the names and attributes of Allah. Because the more we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we're going to love Him. MashaAllah. So if you don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't know who you're worshipping. Why should you worship Him? Okay, so inshallah ta'ala, Ustaz Yahya is going to tell us a lot about this, inshallah ta'ala. Before we begin, inshallah ta'ala, before we begin the lecture, I would like to, inshallah ta'ala, invite one of our students, inshallah ta'ala, our hifz, mashallah, student, one of the hifz, mashallah, student. And inshallah ta'ala, he's going to recite the Quran for us as an inshallah ta'ala, as an opening, inshallah ta'ala, for the session. And inshallah ta'ala, after the lecture finishes, we're going to have another, mashallah, student who will be reciting. So who's going to be the surprise, mashallah, who's this surprise qari who's going to be coming out and doing the recitation for us to begin with? Inshallah ta'ala, he is none other than our student Anas Mahmoud. Say mashallah. Anas Mahmoud, mashallah. Can I invite Anas Mahmoud, inshallah ta'ala?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وعهدهم راعون والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون أولئك هم الوارثون الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون.
تكبير الله أكبر. Can you give me five? ما شاء الله ما شاء الله. That was amazing. ما شاء الله. You. That took me back. ما شاء الله. Took me back. ما شاء الله. ما شاء الله. I'm sure that you've enjoyed it. Am I right? Oh, those of you who had the cameras ready, alhamdulillah, you captured it. Alhamdulillah, that was a very special recitation. It has touched my heart, mashallah, alhamdulillah, beautiful verses. And inshallah ta'ala, we have another surprise for you at the end. Stay seated, inshallah. Don't go anywhere. Listen to this beautiful lecture. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll close it with another beautiful recitation, inshallah ta'ala, from one of our students, inshallah ta'ala, from the Hifdh class. So jazakumullah khairan. Falitfadl mashkuran ya ustazana Yahya, barakallahu fiqh.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى صراط مستقيم صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى أثره إلى يوم الدين أما بعد سلام من الله عليكم ورحمته وبركاته. After praising Allah Jalla fi Ulah and sending salutations upon our Messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, we proceed and we praise Allah and thank Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has allowed us to be here this evening. And we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to forgive our sins in this gathering. And we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to have mercy upon us in this gathering. And we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, just like He united us here this evening or tonight, that He gathers us in Jannah fi Firdaws al-A'la. Innahu jawadun kareem. Ayyuha al-ikhwa wal-akhawat. What we are discussing tonight, it is Allah. And knowing our Lord Allah. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says that when the slave, he knows Allah and he's granted the ability to know more about his Lord and to know his names and attributes, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will allow him to experience a paradise on this earth before the paradise of the hereafter. Rather, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will allow him to see what no eye has seen and what no ear has heard and no one can imagine. before the bliss of the hereafter. Because knowing Allah and being close to Allah and knowing about Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, it increases your love for Allah Azza wa Jal. And the more you love Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the more you obey Allah, the more you worship Allah, the more you know Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the more you fear Allah, the further away you are from the disobedience of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. But that's based on the knowledge of knowing Allah jalla fi ula. And that's what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala created us for. We recited in the salah, قوله تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. Allah says, I have not created jinnkind and mankind except worship me. The verse that preceded that, it was وذكر فإن الذكرى تنفع المؤمنين وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. Remind, O Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام. For verily the reminder, it benefits the believers. Then straight after that, Allah said, I have not created jinnkind and mankind except to worship me. It is as if Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is saying, remind them, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, of their purpose of life, because even that the insan is going to forget. Because insan is kathir al-nisyan. Forgets a lot, that's our nature. We forget the most important thing. We also recited, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Do not be like those نَسُوا اللَّهَ. And nisyan here is not forgetfulness. It is abandoning the way of Allah. Abandoning the path that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has legislated. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as a result of that, He made them forget themselves, i.e. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala left them. Those are the fasiqoon, Allah says. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us that when the individual, he turns away from Allah azza wa jalla in this world, then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will turn away from him in this world and the hereafter. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قال كذلك أتتك آياتنا فنسيتها وكذلك اليوم تنسى. Allah says, whoever turns away from my dhikr, my remembrance, my religion, the Quran, and so on, he shall have a difficult life in this world. But is that it? لا, it extends to the hereafter. ونحشره يوم القيامة أعمى, and we shall resurrect him on the day of judgment blind. قَالَ, he will say, رَبِّ, my Lord, لِمَ, why, حَشَرْتَنِي, have you resurrected me, أَعْمَى, blind, وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا, and I used to have sight in the world. It'll be said, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا, like that, our verses, our signs, they came to you. فَنَسِيتَهَا, and you turned away from it. أي فَتَرَكْتَهَا, you left it, you abandoned it. وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى, and just like that, today you shall be abandoned. Imagine Allah tabarak wa ta'ala saying to you that you are going to be abandoned on the day that you need Allah most. We mentioned this morning after Salat al-Fajr, the athar that's reported from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, where he said, يوم القيامة, a caller will call out. And he will say, where are those who were oppressed in this world, in the dunya? Come forth and seek your right And then he said رضي الله عنه فيفرح المرء بأن يكون له الحق على والده أو ولده أو زوجه وإن كان صغيرا. And the individual will rejoice if he had rights that he could get back from his parents and his child and his wife, even if it's little, they will seek it. There's no nasab that day. فلا أنساب يومهم فإذا نفخ في الصور. Allah says, when the horn is blown and people are resurrected, فلا أنساب بينهم يومئذ ولا يتساءلون. There's no nasab, no lineage, no ties of kin exist then. It will be nafsi, nafsi. Imagine that day Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says to you, you are abandoned. وَالْعِيَذَ بِاللَّهِ. But when the individual يُقْبِلُ عَلَى اللَّهِ, he turns to Allah. How? بِمَعْرِفَةِ اللَّهِ, by knowing Allah عز وجل. Because when you know Allah, you worship Allah. We are not permitted to worship Allah based on ignorance, but rather we are commanded to worship Allah based on knowledge. When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us the path that we ask Him to guide us to every single day, what is that path? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, guide us to the straight path. What is that path? صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, the path of those that you have bestowed your favors upon. From the prophets and messengers and the righteous and the martyrs and so on, they were those who knew Allah, and not the path of those who have earned your anger. Those are those who have knowledge and do not act upon that knowledge. They have earned the wrath and anger of Allah. And not the path of those who have gone astray, meaning they worship based on ignorance and they deviate. But the believers are those who worship Allah with knowledge and they act upon that knowledge. The first knowledge that the individual should be learning about is Allah. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He starts His book, the Quran, by introducing Himself to His creation and praising Him Himself, Jalla fi Ula.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the universe. Alameen is everything except Allah. Rabb. Allah starts off by introducing Himself as Rabb. This name, after His name Allah. And this word Rabb, this name Rabb, Lord, translated to as Lord in the English language, which is a translation that has a lot of deficiency, but it will do for now. Rabb comes from the Arabic word tarbiyah. And look at this. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is saying Rabbul Alameen. Tarbiyah means nurture. The one who nurtures and takes care of the whole universe, everything. Allah nurtures it and takes care of it. With what? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The most gracious, the most merciful. Bi-Rahmatihi, with His mercy. Ar-Rahman came first, straight after Al-Alameen. Because Ar-Rahman, it is the name of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, which shows that it is Rahmah that encompasses everything and everyone, all the creation. Muslimuhum wa kafiruhum, insuhum wa jinnuhum. The Muslim and the non-Muslim, jinnkind, mankind, animals, all creatures, that is the Rahmah that encompasses all of them, straight after Alameen. Ar-Rahman, then Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahim, especially merciful towards the believers. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. Rahmatullah, the mercy of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, it is what Allah Azza has granted us, which is Islam, number one. It's part of the mercy of Allah, blessing. Because what is the definition of rahmah? Rahmah, it is ayyuhal kiram, that you attain everything that is beneficial to you in this world and the hereafter, and that you're protected from everything that is harmful towards you in this world and the hereafter. That is mercy in a nutshell. Comprehensive. So when we talk about the mercy of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He guides you as part of His mercy. when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala forgives you, it's part of His mercy. When Allah bestows His favors and blessings upon you, it's part of His mercy. When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala protects you from harm and evil, it's part of His mercy. When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala protects you from the punishment of the hereafter, it's part of His mercy. When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala protects you from calamity, it's part of His mercy. Rahmatullah wa rahmati wasi'at kulla shay. And my mercy, Allah says, wasi'at kulla shay. It has encompassed everything. فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ. So Allah says, and I'll grant it to those who are God conscious, who have taqwa. And they establish a prayer and they give for the sake of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Action. In order to attain the rahmah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allah is telling us that you need to do the acts that you attain with the mercy of Allah. Allah says to us in the Quran, obey Allah and obey the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. What will happen if you do so? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. That you can attain the mercy of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So when the believer, he knows that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is the most merciful and that His mercy encompasses everything, he does whatever it takes to attain that mercy. He gets closer to that mercy. He asks Allah tabarak wa ta'ala for that mercy. He worships Allah tabarak wa ta'ala based on that name, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, these two names. The athar, the effect of these names should be evident in your lives. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَدَعُوهُ بِهَا. And to Allah belong the best names, the greatest names, the most perfect names. فَدُعُوهُ بِهَا. So call upon Allah تبارك وتعالى. Supplicate to Allah with these names. Ibn Qayyim رحمه الله تبارك وتعالى, he says, الدُعَاء, it is two types. There's dua ibadah, dua which is acts of worship, and dua which is mas'ala or talab, dua which were you familiar with, which is requesting and asking. As for the first, the dua which is ibadah, it is that you do every act of worship for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala based on these names. And he gives you examples, rahmatullahi alayhi rahmatan wasi'ah. He says, Ibn Qayyim, that when you know that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you do what it takes to attain the mercy of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and you abstain from everything that leads to the anger and the wrath of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. You know that Allah azza wa jalla is at-tawwab, so you repent to Allah frequently because He constantly forgives and accepts repentance. You know that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is al-Aziz, the Almighty, the All-Powerful, so you seek only might from Allah and you humble yourself in front of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Show your weakness to Allah because that's your strength, and you do not show weakness to any of the creation, but only attach yourself to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. You know that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is al-wadud, the one who is lovable and makes himself lovable towards you. So you do what it takes to attain the love of Allah. What the Messenger alayhi salatu highlighted, that with it you attain the love of Allah, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will love you and increase your love for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. You know that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is al-kareem, the most noble. So you do acts that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala loves, which is generosity, and that you assist the creation, and that you're generous with your efforts and time for the sake of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the most generous, because He gives you everything out of His generosity without you even requesting it. So you do acts for yourself and others, and you do acts for those who have rights upon you without them requesting it from you, out of your generosity, so that you can attain the blessings of Allah and Allah can increase His blessings upon you. This is what it means, that these names, you are worshipping Allah with them. You are worshipping Allah tabarak wa ta'ala with these names. And the second, it is that you call upon Allah Azza wa Jal with the suitable name. You're asking for provision. You say, Ya Razzaq, Urzuqni, provide for me. Ya Ghafoor, Ighfirli, O the one who constantly forgives, forgive me. Ya Rahman, Irhamni, oh the most merciful, have mercy upon me, and so on. This is what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is telling us to do in the Quran. These names are meant to be evident in our lives. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. That's Allah, He knows خائنة الأعين, What the eye deceives. وَمَا تُخْفِ الصُّدُورُ and what the chests conceal. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says in the tafsir of this ayah, this is referring to, he gives an example, and he says that this is referring to the one who is sitting with his righteous companions, خَائِنَةَ الْعَيُنُ, he's explaining what the eye deceives. When an individual is sitting with his righteous companions, and then a beautiful woman walks in, and when his friends cannot see him, he looks at her quickly and then looks away. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala knows that when the believer is aware of that, no doubt what it does is that it makes him more conscious of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It embeds in his heart khashyatullah, fear of Allah azza wa jalla based on knowledge. And that's what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for. He would say, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, wa as'aluka khashyataka fil ghaybi wa shahada. He would say, ya Allah, I ask you for fear, to fear you. Fear that's based on knowledge. Fil ghaybi wa shahada. When I'm seen and when I'm not seen, when I can't be seen. At all times. In secret and in public, that I fear you, Allah asks you for that. And that's what the believer does. He asks Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to grant him fear, to rectify his heart. But that comes with the more you know Allah, as we said. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was the most knowledgeable amongst the creation regarding Allah. And because of that great knowledge that he possessed, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he was a'badun nas, the one who worshipped Allah the most. To the extent that he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would be praying the ninth prayer and his feet would swell. And it would be said to him, ya Rasulullah, hasn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala forgiven your previous sins, your coming sins? Why are you doing this to yourself? And he will say, alayhi salatu wasalam, afala akunu abdan shakura? Shall I not be a grateful servant, a grateful slave to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala? Why? Because of the knowledge he had of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, it made him want to do more ibadah, which he necessarily didn't have to do, but out of gratitude to Allah and being grateful to Allah and knowing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, it is what motivated him and pushed him to do more and more. Like that, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, who were educated by the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, they were those, amongst them were those who were promised paradise whilst walking the face of the earth. But despite that, they would do so much in order to attain the pleasure of Allah. Why? Because they knew Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. They worshipped Allah because He's Allah, and they knew that that is the purpose that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created them for, is that reason. Regardless of what I have been told. And they've been told by the most truthful, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. But it did not delude them. Rather, it pushed them to do more. And they would still fear. They would fear about where they would end up. They would be afraid about their destination because they knew Allah. You find Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda, he would say that I wish I was a tree and I was not held accountable for anything that I did. Abu Bakr is saying that. Why? Because he's afraid of Allah. He fears Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Fear based knowledge. Umar would say similar statements radiallahu anhu arda. Umar radiallahu anhu arda, he would have two marks down his cheeks because of how much he would cry radiallahu anhu, because of the fear of Allah and reciting the speech of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and knowing Allah. It would affect him like that. And because of the fear that they had of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, they were those who were aware and knew that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is going to hold them accountable for everything that they do. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he was on his deathbed, he chose Umar radiallahu anhu to be the next Khalifa. And you know what he said after that? I know what I'm going to say to my Lord when he asks me, why have you chosen Umar as the Khalifa? He had prepared the answer before he was asked. Umar radiallahu anhu arda, there's an instance that reports one day that he was, when he was the Khalifa, he was busy with the affairs of the Muslims. And a man approached him and came to him whilst he was busy. And Umar had his stick. So this man came to him seeking Umar's assistance to get back his rights because he had been oppressed by someone. So the man came to Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar got agitated and he took his stick and he said, why is it that when your Khalifa is free, you don't approach him, but when he's preoccupied and busy, you approach him? And then Umar hit him with a stick slightly and told him, leave me alone. As soon as Umar radiallahu anhu did that, he regretted it and he felt remorse, and he called back the man and he told him, take the stick and take back your right. The man said, no, I can't do that. Umar said, you must take back your right. The man said, I can't do that. Umar radiallahu anhu said, take back your right or leave it for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala yawm al-qiyamah. Umar assumed that the man was going to hit him and not choose the other option. The man said, I can't do neither. He said, you must choose one. And then he said, okay, I'll leave it for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. As soon as Umar radiallahu anhu heard that, his heart sank and he was overcome by grief and fear. And he locked himself into a room and he cried and he was having a go at himself. And amongst the statements that he said to himself was, Ya Umar ibn al-Khattab, kunta ضعيفا فعزك الله وكنت وضيعا فرفعك الله وكنت ضالا فهداك الله وجعلك خليفة المسلمين ثم أتاك رجل يستعين بك على رد مظلمة فظلمته فماذا تقول بين يدي الله عز وجل يا ابن الخطاب فماذا تقول بين يدي الله عز وجل يا ابن الخطاب فماذا تقول بين يدي الله عز وجل ابن الخطاب. He said, Ya Umar, you were low and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala raised you. Weak and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala granted you strength. Misguided and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala guided you and he made you the Khalifa of the Muslims. And then a man came to you seeking your help and your assistance to protect him from oppression, and then you oppressed him. What are you going to say in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla yawm al-qiyamah, Ya Umar? What are you going to say in front of Allah Azza wa Jalla, Ya Umar? And he kept repeating that until the people, they felt sorry for him, because they knew the reality of Allah and the hereafter. So that struck a chord in him. It is that knowledge. That is that knowledge of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is what keeps you in check. It is what keeps you within your boundaries, so you do not exceed your boundaries and limits. It is what facilitates for you to do more within the boundaries of what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has, or what Allah loves, I should say, and is pleased with. It is what motivates you to follow the example of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and to exert your efforts in doing so. This is the objective, and this is what these people, they had, and because they had that, they achieved great stuff. Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, who's a scholar, she is one who had been educated by the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. She possesses a lot of knowledge, no doubt. She would recite a statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, where Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he says, ثم أورثنا الكتاب الذين اصطفينا من عبادنا فمنهم ظالم لنفسه ومنهم مقتصد ومنهم سابق بالخيرات بإذن الله ذلك هو الفضل الكبير. Allah says, then we have allowed to inherit the scripture those that we have chosen from our slaves. Then Allah says, amongst them are three categories: ظَالِمُ لِنَفْسِهِ, one who is oppressive to himself, وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ, and amongst them is one who has shortcomings, who's in the middle, وَمِنْهُمْ, and amongst them is سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, one who hastens towards goodness and strives with the permission of Allah. Aisha radiallahu anha, when she recited this statement, she would say, أَنَا ظَالِمَةٌ لِنَفْسِهَا أَنَا ظَالِمَةٌ لِنَفْسِهَا أَنَا ظَالِمَةٌ لِنَفْسِهَا, I am one who's oppressive to herself. I'm the first category, the one who's oppressive to herself. Why would they say this? Did she say it just to sound humble? La, they were genuinely humble. Because they knew Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and they knew whatever they did in terms of righteous deeds, it would never be enough. No one can ever claim that they have worshipped Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala exactly the way Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala deserves to be worshipped. But rather, we are humbled and we acknowledge our shortcomings, and rather that's what motivates us to do more and more and more. Because we are not perfect. And because of the knowledge of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala and what and how perfect Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is, they know that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is Al-Afu, the one who pardons. And part of Al-Afu, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He accepts the simple deeds that have shortcomings like the ones we perform. And He overlooks our shortcomings. Jalla fi ula. They knew that. But that kept motivating to keep going, to seek the goodness from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. But ayyuhal kiram, there's something that's very important that one must know. All of this that we mentioned now, that we stated, one can achieve that closeness and nearness to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala when he seeks something from Allah and he requests something from Allah and he does what it takes to attain that. And that is at-tawfiq. Tawfiq from Allah. What is tawfiq? Tawfiq, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, like some of the ulama they say, it is Allah makes your desires in accordance to his pleasure. Allahu Akbar. Imagine that whatever you desire, it is what Allah is pleased with. That is tawfiq. Or Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala guides you to that which he's pleased with. That is tawfiq. And that is something that you only get from Allah. You do not attain it because of your wealth or who you are or your strength or your intelligence and so on. It is Allah who grants it to whoever he wishes. So you seek it from Allah. And like Shu'aib alayhi salam, he said, like Allah narrates in the Quran, وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَإِلَيْهِ أُنِيبُ. And my success, my tawfiq, it is only from Allah. It's only with Allah. Alayhi tawakkalt. Look, now he tells you how you get it. The action point. Upon him I rely, I have tawakkul. Reliance, it is that your heart fully relies upon Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala whilst doing the means to attain what you're trying to attain. Wa ilayhi unib, and he tells you here the action point. And to him I return frequently. I turn back to Allah from my sins. I turn back to Allah with obedience. I turn back to Allah in repentance. With that, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, when you show that you're in dire need of Allah, Allah will grant you that tawfiq. Jalla fi ula. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to grant us tawfiq and the ability to worship him as he deserves to be worshipped. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to assist us in his remembrance and his worship and his gratitude. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to forgive our sins, We ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to have mercy upon us. We ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to grant us the knowledge of Him Jalla fi'ulah. We ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to grant us beneficial knowledge. We ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to gather us in Jannah Firdaws Al-A'la. We ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to protect us from the punishment and the hellfire. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to guide us and to increase us in guidance and to guide others through us. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to grant us taqwa and to accept our deeds and to grant us sincerity, ikhlas, fi al-qawli wal-amal, in our statements and actions. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal for His love and the love of those who love Him and the love of a deed that draws us closer to His love. Innahu wali dhalik wa qadir alayhi wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak alayhi nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakum Allah khair for listening so attentively. Fikum barak.
إن شاء الله. بسم الله، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. جزاك الله خير ما شاء الله أستاذ يحيى for that beautiful ما شاء الله lecture. And brothers, إن شاء الله تعالى. And we want to thank ما شاء الله أستاذ يحيى for delivering that beautiful reminder. And as I promised you, إن شاء الله تعالى, now we go into conclude the reminder with another beautiful recitation from one of our MashaAllah, Hifth class students, inshallah ta'ala. One of the Hifth students. Who's going to be the surprise this time, inshallah ta'ala? We will find out. And the surprise is none other than, MashaAllah, our student, Jibreel. MashaAllah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فلما ذهبوا به وأجمعوا أن يجعلوه في غيابة الجب وأوحينا إليه لتنبئنهم بأمرهم هذا وهم لا يشعرون. فلما ذهبوا به وأجمعوا أن يجعلوه في غيابة الجب وأوحينا إليه لتنبئنهم بأمرهم هذا وهم لا يشعرون. وجاءوا أباهم عشاء يبكون. قالوا يا أبانا إنا ذهبنا نستبق وتركنا يوسف عند متاعنا فأكله الذئب وما أنت بمؤمن لنا ولو كنا صادقين. وجاءوا على قميصه بدم كذب قال بل سولت لكم أنفسكم أمرا فصبر جميل والله المستعان على ما تصفون. وجاءت سيارة فأرسلوا واردهم فأدلى دلوه قال يا بشرى هذا غلام وأسروه بضاعة والله عليم بما يعملون.
That was beautiful, mashallah. You just listened to and enjoyed, mashallah, two of our students from the Hifth class, mashallah. And our student Anas and also our student Jibreel. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve them. Allahumma ameen. And brothers, inshallah ta'ala, I'll give you an opportunity to ask, inshallah ta'ala, the ustaz regarding the lecture, inshallah ta'ala. We've got a few minutes, inshallah ta'ala, if anyone has got a question or anything which is related to the ma'ad, inshallah ta'ala, the Arabic. So inshallah ta'ala, if you want to learn a little bit and regarding the ma'ad, what's the best way to learn the Arabic language, what advice you can get from the, mashallah, from the ustaz, mashallah, especially to find out the path and the route that he took. I remember that he told us some of it last time. Inshallah ta'ala, he can elaborate on it a little bit more. Inshallah ta'ala, we've got a few minutes. And inshallah ta'ala, this afternoon you were there. You saw, mashallah, the attendance and how many brothers and sisters came who have enrolled, mashallah, the ma'had, and they want to come and join us, inshallah ta'ala. So, Ustaz Yahya, this is another opportunity for you to, inshallah ta'ala, encourage our brothers and sisters and in learning the Arabic language, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu fik.
Bismillah. Naam, today we had the open day of Al Furqan College, and of course, I mentioned my last visit regarding the importance of learning Arabic and how important it is. And all of that we mentioned in our lecture, the key to understanding these names of Allah, it's that language. Because these names of Allah, they're not in English. To understand what they mean and to comprehend them and to understand what they necessitate, it is to know the language of the Quran, the language of Allah that He chose. And of course, when the individual, he has the language and he's able to understand, no doubt that it's going to change his life. And he's going to have a different outlook even on life. I can assure you that. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, in a famous statement, he says, من تعلم القرآن عظمت حرمته ومن تعلم الحديث طويت حجته ومن تعلم العربية رق طبعه. He says عليه رحمة الله, the one who learns the Quran, he will be venerated more, respected and honored because of the Quran that he carries. And he says, and the one who learns the hadith of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, qawiyat hujjatuhu's evidences will become stronger. And then he said, and the one who learns the Arabic language, his nature will become softer. The language is not just a language, but rather it's a lifestyle, because it has within it deen. The Arabic language is deen. It is not only a language that you learn to converse with others or to communicate with others, but it is deen itself. Like Umar radiallahu anhu would say, تَعَلَّمُ الْعَرَبِيَّةَ فَإِنَّ الْعَرَبِيَّةَ مِنَ الدِّينِ. Learn the Arabic language because the Arabic language is part of the religion. So when you learn the Arabic language, it actually changes your nature for the better. Because you learn what the language, what comes to the language, it's the whole package. And inshallah ta'ala, we are all being granted the opportunity here, inshallah ta'ala, to learn and embark on that journey, inshallah ta'ala. No doubt, when Allah Azza wa Jalla grants us opportunities and blessings like this, to show gratitude to Allah for these blessings, that you take the opportunity and you benefit from it. So may Allah make us from those who benefit from these great opportunities. Now,
mashallah. And any brother who's got a question from the floor, inshallah ta'ala, relating to the Arabic language or the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, brother. Have you mentioned?
I don't remember mentioning numbers.
Okay.
What is the name that you're referring to? يعني القاهر, القهار يعني, right? نعم. نعم القهار. And you also have القاهر in the Quran. نعم. طيب. The question.
Okay. This is a written question, and from one of the brothers, I said, is it possible for the Sheikh to remind us when it comes to the etiquettes of dua and making dua with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Now, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he taught us that there are certain etiquettes that one must observe when he's making dua and calling upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And he said alayhi salatu wasalam in hadith that when one of you is calling upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, or he desires to call upon Allah azza wa jal, let him start by praising Allah azza wa jal and glorifying Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and then sending salutations upon me, and then he asks Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for what he wishes. So number one, it is that the individual, he starts by praising Allah azza wa jal and glorifying Allah before he asks Allah for whatever he desires. That is number one. And of course, before even that, it is that the individual, he has sincerity, because dua, like any other act of worship, it requires sincerity for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to accept it. Sincerity, that's number one. Number two, it is that you are praising Allah and glorifying Allah azza wa jal. Number three, it is that you send salutations upon the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Right, and you, after that, it is also desirable that the individual, he starts by seeking forgiveness from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala before asking Allah for what he wishes. That in terms of what you say. In terms of what you do, there's certain etiquettes as well. Number one, it is that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he teaches us that when one is calling upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, it is sunnah that he raises his hands in the places that is permitted. That you raise your hands in the times and the places that is permitted to do so, because it makes your dua more acceptable. As the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيِّيٌ كَرِيمٌ يَسْتَحِي مِنْ الْعَبْدِ إِذَا رَفَعَ يَدَيْهِ أَنْ يَرُدَّهُمَا صِفْرًا خَائِبَتَيْنِ. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is shy and extremely generous, and he becomes shy of his slave when he raises his hands to him to return his hands empty. So it makes your dua more acceptable. Facing the qibla also makes your dua more acceptable. These are etiquettes, they're not a must, by the way. Also, that the individual, when he's calling upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he is certain that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is going to respond to him, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "Udu'u Allah wa antum muqinuna bil ijabah." Call upon Allah azza wa jalla whilst you're certain that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is going to respond to you. And also, from the etiquettes, it's that you do not have ajalah, which is hastiness, meaning that you say that I've made dua, Allah hasn't responded to me, khalas, I give up. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us that the one who does that, he would not get a response. Also, from the etiquette, it is that when you're calling upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that you're not heedless, that you are focusing and concentrating what you are stating and saying. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said in the hadith that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala does not accept the dua of a heart that is lahin and ghafil, that is preoccupied or something else, distracted and heedless. Allah does not accept it, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also, part of the question, it was, how do we specifically call upon Allah? What etiquettes are there to call upon Allah with his names and attributes? I mentioned that in the lecture. It is to use the suitable name for what you are asking. And that's why it's important to know the meaning of the word, of the name. That you are asking Allah for a matter, you ask with the name that has that meaning within it. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he teaches us that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he has the greatest name, al-ismul a'zam, the greatest name. Alladhi idha du'iya bihi ajab wa idha su'ila bihi a'ta. That name which, if Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is asked with that name, he will respond. And whatever you request from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala with that name, Allah will give it to you, he will grant it. The ulama, they differ regarding what that name is, because the different ahadith that indicate different things. A lot of the ulama, they are of the opinion that the ismullah al-a'zam, it is Allah. It is the name Allah. It is the greatest name of Allah Azza wa Jal, that if you call upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala with this name, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will respond to you and grant you whatever you request. And we find that a lot in the du'as of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, where he says Allahumma. Allahumma, it is Ya Allah. It means Ya Allah. You're calling upon Allah Azza wa Jal with that name. And Allah, it is, as As-Sibawayh, he says, Rahimahullah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, the name Allah, it is A'raful Ma'arif, the most well-known matter. Allah. And he says, and the ulama, they say that when the name Allah is lifted from this earth, قامت القيامة. When no one knows Allah, Qiyamah will be established. And they also say that one of the reasons why they came to that conclusion, it is Allah, this name Allah, no one dared to name themselves that name. Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala protected that name from any ignorant individual from naming himself that. Even the worst, like Fir'aun, never called himself Allah. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, one day he had a sahabi who was making dua. He said, Allahumma inni ashhadu bi annaka anta Allah la ilaha illa ant al-wahidu al-ahad al-fardu al-samad alladhi lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam heard that, he said, لَقَدَ سَأَلَ اللَّهَ بِاسْمِهِ الْأَعْظَمِ أَلَّذِي إِذَا دُعِيَ بِهِ أَجَابُ وَإِذَا سُئِلَ بِهِ أَعْطَى. He said that that Sahabi has asked Allah with his greatest name, that if he was called upon with that name, Allah will grant you what you request. And from that, the ulama, they conclude that it is the name Allah. Some of the ulama, they believe it is Al-Hayyul Qayyum. Because these two names, they, Al-Hayy, it indicates the perfect sifat and attributes of Allah Azza wa Al-Dhatiyya. And Al-Qayyum, it indicates the perfect actions of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And they say these two names are Ismullah Al-A'zam. And because of the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, where he says that there are a number of verses in the Quran that indicates Ismullah al-A'zam, and all these verses that the Prophet alayhi salatu he mentioned, they had Al-Hayy al-Qayyum in it. Ayat al-Kursi, the ayah Surah Taha, and so on. And some of the Sahaba, they believe that it was Ar-Rabb. And you find that in a lot of the du'as in the Quran, Rabbana, Rabbana. Like Abu Dharr radiyallahu anhu and Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, they believe that Ar-Rabb is Ismullah al-A'zam. Ala kulli hal, calling upon Allah tabarak wa ta'ala with all the most comprehensive names, like these names we just mentioned, that is desirable, especially when you're calling upon Allah Azza for whatever matter you're requesting, because these names, they indicate all the names of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam.
Barakallahu feek, jazakallahu khair, Ustazana Yahya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase you in knowledge, say ameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve you, Allahumma ameen. And dear brothers and sisters, jazakumullah khairan for attending the lecture and benefiting from the Shaykh. And now we are running out of time. And inshallah ta'ala, the adhan will be called, and immediately we are going to pray, because now it's 8:15, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum. And I also would like to take this opportunity and thank our media team for their hard work, and also the amazing work that they're putting out. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase them. And in ajr, Allahumma ameen. Barakallahu feekum. Wa jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا أن تصيبوا قوما بجهالة فتصبحوا على ما فعلتم نادمين واعلموا أن فيكم رسول الله لو يطيعكم في كثير من الأمر لعنتم ولكن الله حبب إليكم الإيمان وزينه في قلوبكم وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان أولئك هم الراشدون فضلا من الله ونعمة والله عليم حكيم وإن طائفتان من المؤمنين اقتتلوا فأصلحوا بينهما فإن بغت إحداهما على الأخرى فقاتلوا التي تبغي حتى تفيء إلى أمر الله فإن فاءت فأصلحوا بينهما بالعدل وأقسطوا إن الله يحب المقسطين إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين أخويكم واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا يسخر قوم من قوم عسى أن يكونوا خيرا منهم ولا نساء من نساء عسى أن يكن خيرا منهن ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض الظن إثم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم إن الله عليم خبير الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم وإن تطيعوا الله ورسوله لا يلتكم من أعمالكم شيئا إن الله غفور رحيم إنما المؤمنون الذين آمنوا بالله ورسوله ثم لم يرتابوا إنما المؤمنون الذين آمنوا بالله ورسوله ثم لم يرتابوا وجاهدوا بأموالهم وأنفسهم في سبيل الله أولئك هم الصادقون قل أتعلمون الله بدينكم والله يعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض والله بكل شيء عليم يمنون عليك أن أسلموا قل لا تمنوا علي إسلامكم بل الله يمن عليكم أن هداكم للإيمان بل الله يمن عليكم أن هداكم للإيمان إن كنتم صادقين إن الله يعلم غيب السماوات والأرض والله بصير بما تعملون الله